To discuss this further, I'm joined by Julia Roshenko, lecturer in policing and criminal investigations at the University of West London and a research fellow in terrorism at the Henry Jackson Society. From the point of view of organised crime, how big a concern is the idea of developed countries, even EU countries, selling their citizenship?
You're speaking about investment schemes, right, when passports are granted to certain individuals because they invest money into a country. And these schemes, they are, of course, great facilitators for money laundering. That's the first concern we have as those who study organized crime. Second concern is that the schemes allow individuals to avoid sanctions. If some individuals are on sanctions list, whether it's US sanctions list or UN sanctions list and so on. And very often those people who buy citizenships, they are actually referred to as politically exposed people. It's a term that denotes individuals who very often need certain checks to be carried out on the sources of their wealth. And that's pretty much one of the concerns.
That is a delightful euphemism, politically exposed people, which I'm going to make an effort to use in conversation more often. But those people, everybody knows who they are. Their motivation, as you point out, is not difficult, that if they are sanctioned as a citizen of a country which has done the wrong thing. How are they able to simply port their citizenship to another passport? Surely the sanction goes with them, not their nationality?
Very often it's the nationality. Sometimes they can have different names as well in a different passport. And the problem here is very often the schemes, they provide anonymity to the people who get naturalized, for example, in Malta or in Cyprus or elsewhere. So there is also this additional benefit of not being identified as such, as a person with a different nationality.
If those loopholes are that obvious, and they do appear to be fairly obvious, why is more done not to stop them? I mean, if you know this and I know this, then presumably countries like Malta and Cyprus know this as well.
I think it's beneficial for certain countries that individuals donate, because one of the regulations and one of the conditions of being granted a passport is that you buy property and to link your provide a link for residency, but also you donate money into the fund. That's what they call it in Malta, in the country's fund. So, and that's beneficial from the point of view of raising money and getting revenues. So financially, it is very beneficial, let's be honest.
So in the specific case of money laundering, which you mentioned, how does the acquisition of a new passport or new citizenship help somebody carry that out?
A person has a right to reside there, family resides there, and also person very often purchases real estate. And real estate is one of the best ways how to invest money that has to be laundered.
What it does seem strange, though, that again, it's that point that if people know this is going on, that it's allowed to persist. Is it surprising that an organization like the EU in particular is allowing this practice to continue by some of its own constituent members, Malta and Cyprus in particular?
Actually, the European Commission's position on that is quite interesting. It's very ambiguous. They neither endorse nor really disapprove of it. And from what I remember is that one thing they demanded from Malta is to introduce the requirement of residency into granting passports. And Malta did later on introduce it in the regulation that an individual had to either reside in the country for a while or had to own real estate to show a link of residency, and otherwise it's not possible to get a passport. So there's some things that are moving on, of course, but I don't think European Union has a really strong stance on that yet.
Does that surprise you, or is it something that you think the EU should have a stronger stance on?
I think they should have a stronger stance definitely on that, because as we've pointed out before, there are security implications, money laundering, and also these passports can be used by organized criminals, the people who are in the criminal networks as well.
And is it just money laundering that's a concern in terms of the crime that a spare citizenship or passport might enable, or are there other avenues that should be a concern as well?
I think it's other concerns too. For instance, what do these passports give you? So these passports give also mobility, the free mobility in terms of visa-free access to many countries of the world and a possibility to live and work in the European Union. That's why the EU nationalities are so valuable. And other countries also sell passports, for instance, the Caribbean, the Dominican Republic, but they don't provide that political vehicle of mobility. And for many businessmen, also including for people whose business activities are illicit, transnational mobility is a key. It's very important to have this transnational mobility. Criminal groups recognized this importance from the very beginning. The Russian mafia in the early 90s, they would go to Israel to get a passport Why? Because Israeli passport gave him a right to travel visa-free to a number of countries, including the EU and the United States and Canada. Israel has become very tough on that now, on fraudulent passports and marriages of convenience for the sake of getting passports. So now the criminals are exploiting other avenues.
I'm not sure of the mathematics and the mechanics of this, but under the investment schemes that we've been discussing, is it actually cheaper to legally acquire citizenship in a particular country than it is to illegally acquire a bogus or counterfeit citizenship or passport?
It's much cheaper to acquire a stolen or fake passport. The prices on the black market are around £5,000 or £7,000, and that's something that is quite common. On the dark web or in other websites that are in open reach as well, it's possible to find either stolen or fake passports, so it's cheaper than acquiring it in a legal way.
Is it theoretically possible, if you're going to run a scheme like this, and it's obvious enough why countries do it, it is, as you point out, a means of raising revenue, would it be possible to construct such a system with enough safeguards that it wasn't possible for people to use it for nefarious purposes?
I think what is needed, countries should ensure that there are regulations in place to safeguard this process and also ensure that people who are applying for these passports, they are checked and their past, their present checked and their position, their countries of origin, what they do if they were involved in some criminal activities or political issues that could seem to be problematic. So more due diligence process and checks. But that's something we see also in the banking industry. And there is always a problem with that. More and more regulations appear nowadays in the banking industry.
Does it strike you, though, that despite this, that this is a practice that is going to become more widespread? Or do you think it will reach a point at which, if it does clearly become a problem, that countries will start to realize themselves that it's perhaps just not worth it?
I think it'll become more widespread. However, considering one of the recent case studies in Malta with the journalist, that journalist was killed, she was actually investigating the names of those people on the list, because the list was anonymous. And so she was trying to figure out who was among those people who had received passport in the last years. So more these cases, if they emerge and people discuss them and there's more awareness, so that could possibly prompt countries to reconsider regulations and make it more difficult. But the way it stands now, I think it will just become more widespread.
I mean, does it get to the point, and you mentioned the Israeli passports as an example, at which there's kind of a reputational market, if you like, which eventually depreciates in terms of a particular passport. Like if a particular passport acquires a reputation for being a purchase of people who you don't necessarily want in your country, does it start to make them more difficult to sell?
Probably, but I don't think that's the case with the Maltese passport yet. It might happen at some point. But and let's not forget that it's not just Malta and Cyprus that are selling passports in such a way. Portugal has the so-called golden scheme based on the investment opportunities. Latvia does. And there's a number of other countries in the European Union. Somehow it's Malta and Cyprus that have come under increased scrutiny. But we should not forget that there are other countries too.
Julia Ryshenko, thank you for joining us.